Amen.
Please be seated. All righty. So, how about that gospel? How would you like to have been in the crowd that day? Jesus seems to have turned a little bit harsh all of a sudden. What on earth has gotten into him? What he is saying does come across blunt and forceful, because this day he really, really wants to make a point. You see, up until now, basically, the crowds have seen only the good stuff. They've enjoyed the assets, but not figured in the liabilities. The crowds have seen miraculous healings and amazing power over demons. The masses of people have clamored to follow him for the next great words of teaching and wisdom, and then for a chance to be healed of their afflictions. They have been comforted by teachings like the Sermon on the Plain, and has gone as far as to raise the widow's dead son at Nain. What Jesus has done has been without a doubt the most spectacular things they have ever witnessed. But now Jesus has to move forward. He knows he is limited on time, and he needs to make sure they know what is involved in following him. He needs to be extremely blunt, and he needs to shock them and use exaggerated language to get their attention. The technique here is called hyperbole. It's something like saying, "We're going to kill him at the game Saturday night." But even in Oklahoma, we realize that's a figure of speech. He needs to emphasize to them that there is a cost, that what they really need to evaluate, what they are willing to do for him and what they are not willing to do. They need to do a little cost accounting and truly recognize the expense involved. If you want to follow, are you willing to pick up your cross? And they don't even know what the cross means. Doesn't mean anything to them yet, or that they don't even know that it's coming. Jesus was a devout Jew. He would have never literally suggested that we should hate parents, should hate family, or hate wives. Jesus would have never truly suggested hate towards anyone. We are supposed to love our enemies, honor father and mother, care for our spouses as if our own body. But as much as we love those, he's saying that we can't prioritize them ahead of God. And as much as we love those in our lives, to put them ahead of God will eventually not work out for them or for us. And people, as frail as dust, won't always be there. God will. Over the long haul, the priority must be to love God and to put him first, so that we can truly love others as ourselves. Putting God in the first thing gives us the ability and the strength to love others and to be the best that we can be for them. He gives him two extreme examples of planning and being very deliberate about our lives. If you're going to build something, it doesn't just happen. If you're going to build a life following Jesus, it will have a cost. Make sure you know what it is. It doesn't just happen. If you were building an important structure, you wouldn't think about tackling it without a plan. You wouldn't be going to fight or go to war. You wouldn't just run at it without a plan. You would plan. You would plan for the best you could possibly do or be. And lastly, he says, "Those of you who do not give up everything you have cannot be my disciples." I'm sure it sounded hard that day. It sounds hard today. That's really hard. But it's not about selling everything we have and giving it to the poor. It's really about priorities. I don't truly believe that Jesus wanted them to give up everything in order to be his disciples. What he was trying to say, what he did want from us, was to give it a true cost accounting. We can't serve two masters. What things in our lives cost too much? It is good to have nice things, but do we ever have possessions that in fact possess us? It might not just be things that possess us. Do we have positions or jobs or prestige or hobbies that sometimes make it inconvenient to be the best followers that we can be? It may not be that we truly try to serve two masters, but that we find ourselves more and more often having to prioritize what we have time for, when the priority should already be decided. More than anything, Jesus needed to commit his followers as he headed to, was committed followers as he headed to the cross. Followers that were in it to the end. Followers that would truly commit to love God and commit to put others before themselves and had actually thought about what it might cost. So, finally, as we go out into the world this week, I want to ask you just to actually devote some quality time for yourself this week, for yourself and for God, to actually make a plan, to actually consider the cost, and to start each and every day with that in mind. For each new day is a new beginning and a new chance to get it right. Now, some of y'all know, or may not, but some of y'all know that I love quotes and finding the wisdom in them and to hang on to. So I'd like to leave you one about plans and new days and being the most important part of the plan. It's from retired Bishop Stephen Charleston from September of 2015. And he writes, "Now is the moment that defines you. Not what you may have done a dozen years ago, not what you hope to you will do in the months to come, but now, here, and with the choices you make today. You are not what other people assume or expect, or even what they want or need. You are who you become each day that you decide yourself what you will do, what you will say, what you will believe. Today is the challenge of God. It is the defining moment in our lives. Over and over again, lived out every morning we awake and entrusted to God every evening as we sleep." Bishop Stephen Charleston. So, every day. Today is the best day to work out our plan for God. God doesn't expect us to get it perfect. As much as I've talked about planning, he knows we will fail some days. God knows that we are a work in progress. But I think God does expect us and ask us each and every day to have a plan. Amen.